Welcome to the Ben Lowrey podcast. This is episode 2, and in this interview, I interview Allan Hennessey, who has been involved with property investing all his life. He also took a detour into the sovereign citizen and tax protester circles, which is how myself and Allan crossed paths in the first place, and we became connected online. And so that's something we have in common in both of our journeys. But since then, he's returned to property investing, which is his core business, and he's going to tell us all about that journey now.
Sure. Well, I have been a real estate investor for 12 years now, and shortly after becoming a real estate investor, I was affected by the United States recession, which was in 2007-2008, which lasted until 2009-2010. And right before the recession, I ended up purchasing a large number of properties in multiple states. And I left myself in a position that I had to figure out some solutions to. And that's where I think my path kind of crossed, which is with some other folks out there that were providing purported solutions to potential contract problems with some of the banks and some of the mortgages out there. Do you remember what I'm talking about?
I do. Yeah, I'm quite keen to talk about that. Now, I really want to get into that, actually. I figured it would be good to just lay a little bit of background for our listeners. So why don't you just carry on telling us a bit more of your story just to begin with?
Yeah. So purchasing all of these properties, and then where the value suddenly declined, I was left in a position where I was on paper owing a large amount of money to the banks, where the property did not support that debt, right? So mm-hmm. I started looking into why some of the things happened the way that they did, and we started uncovering all sorts of irregularities in the paperwork. And then finding that some of these mortgages were actually given by design to fail, but then I was introduced to some other interesting characters out there, like Winston Shrout and Gordon Hall, and a number of other names that float around in that same circle.
Oh man, I don't know where to begin with all this. So let's let's go one thing at a time, because it's been so many years since I used to be I used to have my head really in the financial stuff and I used to read all the news and read all the articles, and I kind of really understood all about the mortgages and stuff like that. But it's been so many years, I'm a little bit kind of foggy on it all. So when you say what was it you said about the mortgages? Something like they were what was it you just said?
Well, it's interesting you say that, because it has been many years. We're approaching 10 years on this stuff. I mean, actually, it's been more than 10 years since some of it. I mean, here we are approaching 2019. But a lot of these mortgages had irregularities. Mm-hmm. They were originated with the design being for them to fail, meaning
that
the folks that loaned that money out, they never intended for those loans to ever be paid back.
So is this a kind of situation where they package it up, they wrap it up, and then they sell it off to other investors, and then they don't care anymore? Is that what you mean?
Yeah, in other words, they never intended to hold on to them. So they kind of made these loans with the design that it was going to be somebody else's problem down the road. And of course, we found out years later that the reason for that was because they took out multiple insurance policies. So it'd be kind of the equivalent to if I took out an insurance policy on your home in case it burnt down, and then conveniently it burned down.
Right. You know? So they were insured against it defaulting?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I see. So they got no interest in whether the person can actually afford to repay the mortgage or not. It's just like the more mortgages they sell, the better it is for them, and end of story kind of thing.
Well, yeah, it was like that, but then it evolved to where they took out multiple policies on these mortgages, to where they would sell it to someone else, but then when it defaulted, the other person was on the hook, but the original party that took out the insurance policy, they got paid, and they got paid with with taxpayer money because the government, the United States government, bailed them out. So these things, everybody got paid multiple times over, but then the homeowner was the one that was left holding the bag. And so, of course, for many years, I was digging into that rabbit hole and seeing where that went, and watched a number of cases get litigated in state and federal court over the years. And I finally got to a point to where I was like, what am I doing all this for? What's the end game? Instead of being obsessed with it, I decided, well, why am I even engaging all of these? Why don't I just move on and get back to real estate investing, which is ultimately what I did. But along the way, throughout that process, there were a number of experts or gurus, that as many would call them, that seemed to have all the answers. And for a long time, I invested a great deal of energy and time inquiring with these folks to get the straight answer on what it is that they were offering. And I'm not sure if I ever fully figured it all out or not, because ultimately both of those gentlemen are now serving very long sentences in prison for some of the actions that they did separately on the side. They got involved with doing some other very fancy paperwork.
I want to lay a bit of groundwork for our listeners. So just to put it in very simple terms, me and you, we got onto this path, and these people that you're describing, they're basically sovereign citizen, tax protester kind of, they're in that realm, aren't they? Just because I think people are sort of familiar with those kind of labels.
Yes, and I believe that's what the government ultimately labeled them as well.
Yeah, and I'm sure they would not consider themselves to be those labels, but I think it's just the easiest way of describing them, isn't it? And this is the first time me and you have spoken, but I'll just give people a little bit of my story because they might not know. I first started listening to the Canadian Free Man on the Land people, Robert Menard and stuff. And, they're questioning the legitimacy of government. Why should we do as we're told? You know, we the people are the actual authority, and we only get the government to on our behalf to govern us. So it's really our consent that gives them the power to govern. And this is the line of reasoning. And so I got sucked into that stuff around about 2009, I think. And then I started listening to Winston Strout, which is a similar kind of thing, but a little bit more sophisticated. He's sort of talking about, you know, financial instruments and contracts and bonds and promissory notes and banking. So it was like a level of sophistication, or so it appeared, up. And then somewhere along the line, I came across the website and the information of Gordon Hall and Brandon Adams, who were doing a very similar kind of thing. They were sort of it's very hard to describe and summarize, isn't it? How would you describe, you know, the overview of what they were promoting?
Well, what they had going on that really attracted me was that they seemed to have the answer to resolve just about any problem that would show up, you know. So they with regard for me, you know, we had all these mortgages that the banks were essentially saying that you have no option except for to let us take it through foreclosure. Mm-hmm. You know, so there is no other option. We're just going to take everything through foreclosure. You're going to have these foreclosure on your record. There is no other option. So even something where, you know, traditionally there would be a mitigation where you'd negotiate, you'd try, they would compromise, you would compromise, you'd come up with some sort of a repayment plan. You know, the banks were really at that time saying, no, we'll just foreclose. Thank you. That's it. And so we were really there was a large group of us homeowners out there that were looking for answers. And the timing of gentlemen like Gordon Hall and Winston Strout couldn't have been more perfect back in 2009, 2010. And so they were offering essentially what they called a commercial solution or a commercial redemption scheme, where essentially you should be able to, in theory, resolve any problem that you might have. So whether it was a mortgage foreclosure issue, you could essentially use some some fancy footwork and some fancy paperwork, and that should resolve the problem. And so we started seeing some success. We started utilizing some of those techniques. One of them early on was being accepted for value. Where essentially you're claiming something and then giving its value back to somebody. And that was an interesting theory and things. And what made it really so compelling was gentlemen like Winston Shrout he was a history buff, right? So he really had a lot of facts that he could recite to any person about the history of the United States and the history of commerce in the world globally and how it all ties together. And it made it all sound really believable.
Yeah,
right?
yeah, sure. It's very, cult-like.
Yeah, they had success stories. We're working with people that last week they did this successfully, this week they did this successfully, and you can be the next person, And so it was really easy to get caught up in that.
Yeah. Again, just to clarify for our listeners, one of the concepts was that, when banks lend out loans, they really only sign in like a promissory note or rather the borrower sign in a promissory note. And so one of the main principles that these guys were promoting is that all money is created on the signature of a man, on the promise of a man kind of thing. And so it was this idea that we could discharge debts by sort of essentially writing an IRU. And there was this loose line of reasoning that, the notes that come from the central bank, like Federal Reserve notes or Bank of England notes, were promissory notes, and the bonds that the government issues, all these financial instruments, they're just promises. And so the line of reasoning that they were promoting is, if they can do it, we can do it. It's all just promises. We can write a promise and we can discharge the debt just as easily as it was created, kind of thing. And so on that basis, but they also, I know Winston and Brandon and Gordon, they're also saying the same thing should work with also like criminal charges and stuff. And they really overpromised. They really made some very, they really gave the impression that you could get away with sort of anything, and just your signature could kind of discharge any kind of problem, really. That's pretty much what they presented, do you think?
Well, I think one of the things that made it so interesting was that, just like Winston Shrout, Gordon Hall and Brandon Adams, they took a lot of truths, eternal truths out there, so things that are true, and then they applied them whatever direction that they wanted to. So it's actually a lot of the things that they were saying were true, but they don't work. It doesn't work that way in the real world, right?
Yeah. Well,
it might be true that you could discharge something in commercial, and it might be true that our birth certificates are registered and that there are bonds that the government has to offset any liability for, whatever. I mean, those things are so complicated that it's very difficult for an average mind to even comprehend or understand. I mean, I had a real challenge with following it all, but at some point you get to where there's a level of trust built, and then you start taking someone's word for it.
Yeah, and it's a very dangerous situation, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because, yeah. I mean, I want to hear about, how it affected you. But for me personally, I lost my driving license on this stuff. I mean, I got it back now. I had a 6-month ban. But by following the advice of these kind of gurus that say, if you get pulled over by a policeman, you say this and you say that, and then they can't do anything to you. And if you go to court, you say this to the judge, and then, he has to let you go. I followed some of this stuff. I feel like an idiot now, looking back on it in hindsight. I'm an idiot.
I used a lot of it in court. So, like, I got a ticket. A traffic ticket. And then on one particular occasion, I can remember that I went into court, but there's all these rules, right? And so it's very true that the court has a lot of history. Courts go back to even of course for British, in America, our courts are based upon the common law courts of British history. And the courts of chancery and all that kind of stuff. And so you had all these separate courts that, were unified in America here to one court. But And you had all these rules that essentially there was like a, you know, merchant law, and then there was you know, that the court is like a ship, and that if you board the ship, you're subject to the captain's rules and the rules of the vessel. And there's so many different things that
right.
I remember I was practicing some of these things in court with the advice of Gordon Hall, right? So I would avoid entering the courtroom completely. So I would be standing at the edge of the courtroom, kind of leaning at the door and yelling at the judge from the door.
Right.
I mean, so it was kind of like this entertaining show every time I had to go into a courtroom and try one of these things, you know, some antics, and everybody would be going, what is going on? What is the matter with this guy? Why doesn't he just come in? You know? So in the end, there were a number of experiences that I had where I would frustrate the judge, and the judge did not know what to do. And even then, when they would just try and they would respond by putting some paperwork into the case or setting another hearing or, you know, whatever they needed to do. And so then things went from how you act in court to actual paperwork. And so then it really started getting to where who was better at the paperwork, because it just became this back and forth thing where, you know, you would notarize some documents and you would serve the other parties. But then I started, you know, having these parties that would avoid service and playing their own games back. And then there was one case in particular where I felt that I won and I was in court and I told the judge, well, this matter has already been resolved, you know, by the paperwork that's in the record. And the judge said, well, we'll have to look at this and reschedule this hearing. So they basically continued it out. And so then they came back scheduling a whole separate hearing that was just to get rid of my paperwork. So they scheduled a hearing saying, we need to cancel and remove all of this paperwork from the record because it's frivolous and it doesn't have any purpose. And but they had to do it because I had them kind of in a corner. So it's kind of interesting because there is some truth and reality to it, but in the end, when you're dealing with a municipality or the government, I mean, if they want to win, they're the ones that have all the resources to essentially tilt the scale in their own favor to win. So even when you win, you still lose, so to speak. And that's what I think ultimately happened, because I did monitor some of the cases that Winston Shrout, his criminal case, and Gordon Hall's criminal case. And, you know, if you look at the docket, it certainly shows that they have been continuing to exercise these tactics throughout their criminal cases.
Just for the listeners, they were ultimately unsuccessful there. I mean, Gordon's been in prison for how long? Years now?
5 years now, and Winston for 3, I think, now. So,
Winston just got sentenced recently, just a month or two ago.
Was it? I haven't even followed up on that. So.
Yeah, his case, it was really dragged out. I mean, I think he first got indicted years ago, and it's been a long, drawn-out process. I think he was found guilty almost 2 years ago, and they only just sentenced him. And I don't think... he's due to surrender himself to the prison any time now, I think. He may be in now. And Brandon went to prison. So ultimately, all these gurus, basically, you know, just to put it in simple terms, their theories were unsuccessful. You know, come the end.
Yes, not only were they successful, but I believe that they're.
No, I said unsuccessful.
Yeah, unsuccessful. There are also, I think, case in point, that there's so many things that you could get caught up in. And there's so many ways that they could win. And then even when there's not, they'll find a way to win
at
any cost, right? So even if you're right or even if you're wrong, it really doesn't make much of a difference, especially in the context of a criminal action. However, you know, there's certainly been some interesting cases where there have been people that, you know, were facing something much less serious, not a criminal charge, but maybe a civil case where they've been successful at one way or another achieving the desired result.
I used to notice that there was like fairly low level stuff that was reasonably easy to get rid of, you know, maybe parking tickets or maybe credit cards or like small unsecured loans and things. And what I noticed, people basically creditors will give up quite easily, you know. If you owe a small amount and it's unsecured, the banks will very often just let go of it. And what I noticed was people that were into all this stuff, they would take that as kind of, you know, as concrete proof that, you know, whatever process or whatever paperwork they were doing was successful. And they would kind of somehow imagine that the same paperwork would work on any kind of criminal charge. And that's not true. It's a very different when it's dealing with a criminal thing. That stuff doesn't go away. You can't just, you know, shake it off. And that's what I used to notice. There was this very lackadaisical, blurry, you know, people would get carried away believing their own superpowers when really all they succeeded in was perhaps getting rid of a parking ticket or something.
The really interesting part of the whole thing was that you had where some parts of it were successful, but it's hard to put your finger on where it failed or where it could work or where it would work. And then you end up getting so confused that you kind of, you know, you're done with the whole thing. Like I felt at some point I got to where I was like, I can't even think about this stuff anymore. It's just too, it's too overwhelming.
Yeah.
You know? And so,
yeah. And so, how did it impact you directly? I mean, in terms of, I guess, were you doing these kind of processes on your mortgage related stuff to do with your properties? Were you?
Yeah, so I owned 27 properties at the end of 2007. So each year that went past, I was dealing with another foreclosure, another foreclosure, another foreclosure. And so I had to do something. And so I started just fighting back, and I started networking with other people and going on some of these calls back and podcasts back in the day. And then next thing you know, I talked to Winston Shrout over the phone once, and I had mentioned to him some of my observations of how, of maybe some potential ideas of how this could work. And he asked if he could come up and meet me in person, and he did. And he came and drove up from Portland, Oregon, up to Tacoma, Washington, where I live. Right. And we met for about 5 hours and just talked about many different things back and forth. And at the end of that meeting, he acknowledged that we had a pretty interesting angle of essentially modifying the documents that we originated. So the original documents that you signed, of basically claiming that they were in error and modifying those. And so that was in 2010 that he invited me to present this information at his seminar in Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. And so in 2010, I went and presented for about an hour in front of 300 to 400 people in a crowd, and everybody loved it. And I had essentially a business that was born out of that where I had probably 200 people that signed up to get our assistance services, which we essentially did an analysis of all of their loan documents. And we provided some documents that would allow them to modify their previous documents and file those.
But how do you mean modify? I mean, to me, that sounds, I mean, I would presume you can't modify a contract because how does that work? I don't understand.
So when you have a two-way contract, you're right. You can't modify something that's already been, you know, countersigned, right? So if you and I sign a contract between each other that this is what I'm going to do and this is what you're going to do, and we both sign it, well, and then it can only be modified by mutual agreement. Well, when you have a promissory note, well, that's a one-sided agreement. There's only one party that signs that. The bank never signs it. The same with the security instrument or deed of trust. It's a one-sided, what we call an adhesion document. So it's the person that drafted, it's their document. They signed it and they provided it. And so essentially we came up with this concept where we decided that those documents were completed in error and that we were going to modify those documents to be correct and file them with the county. Well, it worked for a while. It really threw the banks for a loop. They really did not know how to respond to that. And for I don't know, maybe 500 or 600 homeowners, they all were successful at keeping the bank away and remaining in their homes.
I see. What, like for, but for how long? Like forever or?
No, there, well, I don't know. I stopped keeping track of a lot of these, but many, well, like 5 years later, there were still many people that were still in their homes.
Right.
I know over time now, the banks have really, they've come back full circle and come back around and come and repossessed many of those properties now. But
Right. So
especially
was
since there was nothing new going on,
when the bank began legal proceedings, was these modified promissory notes used as the defense against the claim?
Yeah, so then we had we took our theories and practices to a couple different attorneys, and they agreed that we had, some standing to stand a leg to stand on, and so they agreed to pick up these cases and fight them in court, and so that's where things got really interesting because all we did was provide the service of analyzing all of the loan documents, and then essentially providing a referral to an attorney. And that's where, things went really well as a business until they got out of control. And I had about 40 employees. Yeah, 40 employees we scaled up to, and 30 of them were in the sales department or, taking calls. I ended up finding out that many of them were making misrepresentations, like telling people that they were going to get a free house. And that was not something they were ever supposed to be representing.
That's a hell of a business you had there, then.
It grew so fast. I mean, this was all in a matter of like 6 months. And
Jesus.
so once I realized that there were misrepresentations taking place, I and out of and things were out of control, I just decided to shut it down. I also had a few visits just before that. I had a few visits from some government officials that from the alphabet agencies that were pretty intimidating. They came in their suits and everything, and black sedans, and they essentially sat down with me and said, if you want to keep doing this, we have a problem with it. But if you want to shut it down, then we're okay with that.
Oh, I see. So it
And
was
I
like,
said,
if you stop now, we won't start,
"We'll leave you alone. Yeah, we'll leave you
leave you.
alone if you just, but if you don't, then we're going to find a way to shut you down, And so I was like, well, everybody, other people were misrepresenting. It wasn't something that was going to go anywhere. So I finally decided that I just need to get back to what I know best, which is investing in real estate.
Wow,
That's what
what's
I've been doing ever
crack?
since.
At what point in that journey were you involved with Gordon Hall? Tell us about that bit specifically, because excuse me, I've kind of got mixed feelings about Gordon Hall. Because on one hand, I can see now in retrospect that a lot of what he was saying was did not comport with reality. But on the other hand, I really like the guy. I mean, in terms of, I used to enjoy listening to him. He's a very cool dude. He got a lot of charisma. He's very kind of, I don't know how you describe it. There's something I really liked about the guy. So what was tell us your experience of Gordon Hall.
Gordon Hall was very verbose. You could sit there and listen to him talk, and you're always anticipating the next word that he's going to use that you've never heard of before that has significant meaning to it. Mm-hmm. So you'd always be sitting there waiting for him to come up with some word that you'd be writing down as soon as he says it, and you'd be looking it up. He'd say, grab your Black's Law Dictionary and look up this word, and you'd look it up and go, wow. And it would just blow your mind, the depth of knowledge that he had. And the difference that he had over Winston Shrout was very sizable. Winston was this kind of old guy that was kind of like talking to your grandfather. But Gordon Hall was kind of the man that was smooth talking to, that you would see picking up on women, maybe, because he has that type of talent in his voice delivery, in the manner. It was almost hypnotic the way he would speak.
Oh, yeah, I completely agree. He had a tremendous charisma. I remember reading, his backstory. There was some old articles about his sort of younger years, and he used to be a property developer, didn't he? And he was very successful, multimillionaire. He had a chain of gyms and stuff like that, and he had a huge mansion that was, one of the biggest mansions in the United States. And, I like those kind of people. I've always been drawn to kind of successful people, and he's a cool dude. And and just for the people that are listening that won't know, Gordon went to prison about 20 years ago for stock manipulation or something to do with mm-hmm. securities yep. fraud or something, and I think he did 7 or so years I don't know if it was the late 90s or something. He reminds me of what's the thing when he flies too close to the sun? I don't know what that what's that story? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Gordon's so ambitious. He got so carried away believing his own abilities that he just tampered with the government too much, and
Well, ultimately, what took him down, from my understanding, was that he accepted custody of some illicit funds. So there was, I think, there was another gentleman, from what I understand from reading the news about it, but there was this other gentleman, I believe, that was facing some sort of criminal prosecution, and he decided to give the money to Gordon to go and hide it, essentially. So in accepting those illicit funds, he was charged with a crime for that. And I believe that's what took him down. Now, he was also charged with, doing those, what did they call those?
OID, 1044.
Yeah, the OID, the 1099 OID, right?
1099, yeah.
Yeah, but OID, you got it right. But he was also, this was essentially where you were using a number of different credits with the IRS to get them to pay you money, essentially.
Do you know what, Alan?
Or to offset debts, yeah.
I remember at the time, right, because I used to listen to, Brandon's seminars about OID, and, excuse me, sorry, and I'm pretty switched on when I want to be, right? And I went away and read the actual IRS documents, the actual, the instructions. I went away, read all the manuals, I read up exactly until I really understood what the OID process actually was. And it became really clear to me that it was nothing to do with what Brandon was saying. Like, Brandon and Gordon had basically and completely misunderstood what it really was. Somehow they'd convinced each other that you're getting your money back from the government and it's your money or something, and I could see from reading the instructions that's not at all what it was. It was to do with when companies issue bonds and stuff, and that is something to do with sometimes they discount the face value of the bond, but that discount has to be, they have to account for that in the taxation, in the accounting somehow.
Right, somewhere else. For every plus Yeah, minus, right?
Yeah, exactly. It's like the equivalent of interest, you know, and the discount, it has to be calculated. So whoever gets the benefit pays the income tax on it
Right.
effectively. And the original issue discount forms are to do with the proper reporting of that. Nothing to do with what
That's right.
Brandon was saying. And what people were doing, and what Brandon and Gordon were basically encouraging people to do, is to. I mean, I don't think they even thought they didn't think they were doing nothing wrong. They were just oblivious, right? They believed their own theories, and they were getting people to fill out these forms, and it was tricking the IRS into issuing a tax refund. Basically, they were just filling out the numbers in such a way that would trigger the IRS to think that it owed you money back. And because the IRS didn't have Because nobody would be so dumb as to do this. The IRS didn't have proper checks and balances in place to verify, people's paperwork, and they were just issuing refunds. And they were issue. I mean, you can probably tell me more stories about this, but they were just issuing huge refunds, you know, in the tens or the hundreds of thousands, just kind of automatically, just you know, and
There was another group that we came across over those years that they ultimately ended up, but there was like 25 people. They all got indicted, and all of them went to prison. And there was m millions of dollars in refunds, millions. I mean,
Jesus.
like I don't know, $12 million or something like that. That was received by them, and they already spent it and everything. I mean, this is kind of crazy stuff, but you nailed it right. That essentially people were t they were these guys were taking a law and a set of protocols that the government uses, and essentially applying them to something a little bit different. And so it seemed to make sense. And even like you said, the IRS wasn't didn't really. It took them years to catch on to what was going on.
Oh my God,
Before they did it.
I've never heard of the group of people that you mentioned. That was news to me.
It's called man, it's been so many years, but what was it called? The old something group.
I mean, how much more dangerous a hobby could there possibly be? Besides from, like, I don't know, jumping off buildings or skydiving or something like that. I mean, messing around with paperwork like this, where you're going to end up doing a 10 or 20 year jail sentence, that's about as risky as it gets, right?
Well, I guess here's what everybody was feeling at the time. Everybody was feeling that this knowledge was specifically in place in law to be available for those that are sophisticated enough. So there was kind of this idea that if you were of a certain level of affluence or influence, that somebody in the government would let you know, hey, you don't have to pay bills anymore. You could just do this. Right? So it was almost like if you were a VIP or somebody special, that they would, it was like the equivalent of having a black credit card, right? Where there's no limit. You don't have to pay it back. Everybody had this idea that, oh, we're getting this information that essentially turns us into a celebrity or somebody important because we know it now. And we get to use this where not many people are smart enough to even use it. So it was like if you were smart enough to follow what was going on and that you could understand and that you felt that you could understand it, you had this feeling like you were superior than everybody else, that you were now part of a different class of society.
Something I noticed very early on is that gobbledygook and nonsense can appear as sophisticated information, and it can, and because it doesn't make sense, it can feel as if like the reason it doesn't make sense is because it's very, very sophisticated. And I think that there was a lot of that at play in this kind of stuff, right?
Well, there's also, in all of us humans, it seems. I have six children. My sixth child is going to be born in January,
All right.
and so I, and I have teenagers right now, and it seems that at some point in the human cycle of life, that we all want to kind of revolt or chart our own path separately from that which has been given to us, and so. it seems that back then, the consensus amongst the group of people that we were all kind of talking to each other was that this was our chance to really chart a new path and to do things differently and to get what's rightfully ours. And there were so many different feelings going around, especially when, 2009, all of the banks got bailed out, even though everybody knew that they were up to no good. And then you had, that was when the Occupy Wall Street movement started. You had all these different movements of people that were just tired of things not going the way that they expected them to. And there was this whole feeling that it's okay because we can make it right.
Yeah, there's something very exciting about it all, really, and it can be very addictive, can't it? Sort of feeling, feeling that you're a part of a kind of adventure tale. That really meets a lot of emotional needs in certain kinds of people. Because I think with in the conspiracy, the conspirosphere, let's call it, it does attract a lot of people that are a little bit lost and don't feel like they've got a great deal of meaning and significance in the world, and suddenly, they stumble across this kind of information that is quite exciting. It makes them feel that they're privy to special knowledge, and it's very emotionally appealing on many levels. And I think that's why it is so easy to get sucked in by a lot of this stuff.
Well, that and there's also so many things in this world that are being artificially controlled. You have from international organizations like the United Nations and all the way down, you've got in these groups that are controlling so many things in this world that there's a lot of people feel like they don't have any control. And so anytime that's the case, you're always going to have these folks that are looking for the answers on how to fix that and how to right that. And so you get a lot of intellectuals that are very smart people that are looking for answers to the questions that they have. So people are like, well, why are things this way? Why is this way? It's not fair. And then they end up looking, trying to find an answer in a conspiracy situation where they're like, well, okay, that fits the mold for what I'm looking for, so I'm going to accept it as truth now.
And I think the truth is very uncomfortable, that we are not governed by consent, we're governed by force, and we're pretty powerless, and we
It's
cannot
kind of
just.
interesting, though. I'll have to stop you there because we actually are governed by consent. Even the government knows there's more of us than them. The challenge is, though, that in this technological age, they have such advanced weaponry, even of the psychological type, that they're really the notion that all of us, citizens, are all going to unite under one united force and we're going to be successful at overthrowing a government. That's just not going to happen. Back in the Revolutionary War days, where they had some basic muskets, and other than that, just some really basic skills, no technology to speak of whatsoever, that sort of thing was possible. But now, I mean, gosh, you've got the things like the Patriot Act that give the United States government very broad powers. In England there, you have very similar laws and everything that give the government very broad powers to do whatever they need to sustain and continue on the path that they decide, as a consensus. So it really is interesting that they say that we are governed by consent, but the truth is they have so many controls in place that the idea that the people will control their own destiny is just not reality.
That's right. I agree. Hey, I just wanted to jump back into the Gordon Hall thing again because I think we kind of went off on a tangent. But were you working with Gordon? Like, what did you have some kind of arrangement with him or something?
Yeah. So I early on was just looking for answers, and so I was on a lot of his conference calls that he held, and next thing I was asking questions, so many questions, that he was like, well, let's have a call off, on the side, and let's talk about this stuff. And so I, okay. And so then I spent some time talking to him about stuff and consulting with him, and I actually paid him a great deal of money to spend that time with me to talk me through a lot of these things. And then I had what I felt was a good understanding of it. So then when I was on the phone, any future conference calls, he would actually bring me up and ask me to participate in the call, and to provide my two cents and my perspective on things. And that's it went that way for just a couple of months, I think. And then I got to a point to where I had to, to shift gears. I had to move away from that whole thing and get back to having a productive life and making money, and paying for my own cost of living. And so that I think that was where, somewhere in there in 2010, I decided I was done with it all. I was over it. And then so early 2011, I shifted back. I was just okay, let's go look back at investing in real estate again. And I kind of turned away from it all. And then, of course, in the years that passed since then, that was where each of them, started that by continuing with it all, the government essentially had enough and decided to pursue criminal charges against them,
And how's things now? How's the market? How's your business? What you been up to?
Yeah, life is great. In the years that passed, I acquired more properties and put a lot of work into them. After the recession, the banks were not lending money, so getting capital was hard to come by. So we started working on different creative situations for how to acquire real estate, such as owner financing and subject to financing. This is essentially where the owner will carry the note instead of having to go to a bank to get a loan. But then we also looked at some other creative ways of how to increase the income that could come from a property. So we started making improvements to properties, but then we also started looking at the vacation rental phenomena. So you've heard of Airbnb, I assume, right? Okay. So Airbnb is not that old. As a matter of fact, I mean, so when I was just getting back into real estate investing, Airbnb just started becoming popular. And so my wife and I decided to furnish some of our properties and rent them out as vacation rentals. And it worked out really well for a good 5 years. We did that combined with some other strategies. But then, we had a few bad experiences that kind of turned us away. We had a couple of groups that came in and hosted major parties in the properties where there was some destruction and damage that took place. I even had one guest that caught the unit on fire. So there was a house
Oh
fire.
no, right.
Then there were thefts. There were th things that got stolen. There were so many things that we were like, ah, this is too much. So then we even looked at converting those properties to boarding houses, where essentially you have this subgroup of society that has a hard time affording the actual cost of housing. So if you were to go out and get your own loft or apartment, there's the monthly rent cost that's there, but then you also have your utility costs and whatever other costs that are involved there. And there's a lot of folks out there, if they're just earning minimum wage, they can't afford that. The entry to get into there is just too high. And so there are a number of people that need to have living or housing, but they can only afford a certain amount. And so we found that by taking like a 5-bedroom home, for example, and instead of renting it to one person or one family and getting a certain amount, that by renting each individual room to a separate person, that we could charge more for each of those rooms because they're affordable. And so then overall, the total amount of income that comes from the property now exceeds what we would have received from it if we had just rented to one party.
I see. Right. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Hey, I'm curious, how did you begin as an entrepreneur? Like, what got you into property? Have you always been a businessman, or how did that go?
I've always been in business. I was employed in my younger years, in my 20s, but then right around my mid 20s, I had a friend that was in the mortgage business, and we had worked at a previous job together doing sales just for a company that was into technology. And so he said, "Hey," he called me up and said, "Hey, you got to come work over at this company. We're making six figures over here." This is in 2003, and I said, "Well, all right, I'll come down and check it out." And I did, and I started making great money right away, just as a mortgage broker. And I had a number of clients of mine that were real estate investors. So when I'm looking at their tax returns and all their financials, I was able to see how much money they were making just by owning real estate. And that was really the moment where I kind of turned a corner and I decided, well, I need to become a real estate investor. And so I purchased a number of books and courses and read all that stuff and studied it really well. And then I was ready. I quit my job working as a mortgage broker and I decided, okay, I'm a real estate investor. It's time to go buy a house. So I took the money that I had earned in the mortgage business and I went and made my first offer on a piece of real estate here in Tacoma, Washington. And everything was going well. A few days later, and the offer got accepted, by the way, and so everything was well. And until a few days later, when that seller called me and said, "I'm sorry, I decided to take a deal somewhere else with somebody else that offered more money." And I said, "You can't do that. We already have an agreement. You already signed it." And he said, "Well, you can sue me if you have to, but I already took more, so, some money from the other guy too." And I go, "Oh, great. What's this is going to be a lawsuit." And I said, "Well, give me the number of the person and I'll contact them and work it out between us." And so he did. And I called the guy, and he's a medical doctor with his own practice and just does some real estate investing part time. And he invited me down to his office, and I met with him. And he asked me, "How many?" He said, "You're a real estate investor, so how many properties have you owned?" And I was really proud at the time, and I told him, "This is my first one." And he started laughing. And I asked him, I said, "What's so funny?" And he said, "No, nothing is." He said, "I'll tell you what, I'll make you a deal of a lifetime, an offer you can't refuse." He said, "I'll pay for everything, all of the renovations. We'll use all my workers, and we'll get it done. And then we'll sell the property and we'll split 50-50 the proceeds." And I said, "Oh, deal. Okay." And I shook his hand and on we went. And 6 months later, we finished it. And I made $37,000 was my cut. And all I had to do is just pay attention and learn. And so I had basically a mentor by default. He was able to guide me through the process, show me everything, and I took that money and I went and bought two more houses in Texas, Dallas, Texas. And so I was single at the time, I was young at the time, and so I was, jumping on a plane to go from Washington to fly out to Texas, and then renting a pickup truck, and then going to Home Depot and buying thousands of dollars worth of tools and supplies and fixing a house myself and hiring some people along the way was not a big deal back then. And so I did that and made some good money. And then I took that money and just kept on buying more and more and more and more and more until later that year, I ended up with 27 total. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
My God.
So, that's how I got my start in the business. Since then, I've just been really fortunate to meet a number of other talented individuals. I continue to meet to this day. I continue to network and meet with people in our local market and on a national basis and try to learn, as much as I possibly can to keep sharpening my craft and getting better at it.
That's wonderful. Hey, what do you think of Grant Cardone? I started listening to him recently. Do you rate his stuff?
He's got a great story. He's another underdog story where, at some point in his life, I don't remember when, but he tells a story about being homeless and addicted to drugs.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah, it's really impressive.
Where
Yeah.
he felt that he was at the end of his rope and that he was ready to commit suicide, and then to go from there to, to being worth having the high net worth that he has now. I mean, the guy's worth, tens of millions now.
Yeah.
So he's got a great story, and he's just been extremely successful. I look forward to meeting him someday in person and being able to get my two cents out of him as to, what would be some great advice. It seems like he has lots of it.
Yeah, absolutely. Just to give you a little bit about my journey, after I finished with all the stuff that we were talking about, I got to a point probably similar to you where I thought, this is enough, I've had enough of this, I'm sick of this. And I actually got into fitness and yoga and acrobatics and stuff. That's just what I did. I'd never done it before.
I remember, because you and I have been friends on Facebook for all these years, I think. And
Yeah.
so I remember in the beginning you said, I want to get, I want one thing in life, and that's I want to be able to do a handstand for 1 hour without.
Yeah, that's right. It was around about 2013 that I started getting into that stuff. And I've really spent the last 5 years pretty much doing yoga and handstands. And just really recently, just this year, just this last few months, I started getting to the point where I'm fed up with it. And because, I've always been interested in business, and I was kind of successful when I was younger, in my early 20s, and I messed it all up. I went bankrupt, and it kind of left a bad taste in my mouth. It takes some time to kind of get over things, doesn't it? When things go wrong, it does have an impact on your psychology and the way you feel, so it took me several years to sort of to process that, and I'm only now just literally getting to the point where I feel like I want to do some new. I'm fed up with handstands, I'm fed up with yoga, I want to be in business again, and that's where I'm at the moment. I don't own my own property. I really want to be successful, but I haven't decided what I'm going to do yet. And I would love to be in the property business, and I'm not really sure where to begin. But hearing your story, that's why I asked you how you started, because that's particularly interesting to me. Yeah, because I'm kind of at that point now. I'm 35. I don't have anything to speak of in terms of. Besides being able to do a handstand, I don't have any net worth or anything. But yeah, I think I'm at the start of whatever it's going to be,
Well, I've noticed over the years, though, also that you've been able to get really good at sculpting your own physique.
I did that.
And then you were also doing the hen parties too, no?
I still do that. Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about what that means exactly.
Well, it's basically, I think in the States you call them bachelorette parties, is that right?
Okay. Yeah, that's right.
So in England we call them hen parties. So it's when a group of girls, when the girls getting married, and what I do is life drawing. So it's naked drawing. So I'll stand there and just hold a pose, and it's just like an art class. They draw you, but it's just kind of light-hearted fun. But the reason I got into that is because when my hair fell out in 2012, I got total alopecia. And all my hair fell out. I've got no eyebrows, no eyelashes, nothing. And because of that, I became very kind of self-aware or self-conscious of my appearance. And that's the reason why I started going to the gym and stuff, and I started getting in shape was because of that, because I was desperate to kind of improve the way I felt about myself, because and then one thing led to another. And yeah, and I started doing the hen parties, and I still do it. It's relatively easy, it's relatively good money, and it's quite enjoyable, and I'm, it's kind of, Yeah, I just do it on weekends, and it's fine. You know, I make a living doing it. It's not making me rich, but it earns me a living. And so yeah, it's cool. It's kind
It's
of one of those
certainly,
bread and butter. Say again.
yeah, it's certainly something different, you know, and not everybody gets to do something like that, you know. So that's, I've always found it quite interesting to see that you're doing that. But
Yeah.
yeah, there's getting back to what you had asked about real estate. You know, I became compelled with real estate early on because I had a number of different people confirm for me a few realities. Number one, that if you t there are more people that have acquired wealth from real estate than everything else combined. So if you think about the entire global economy and all of the money that's out there in existence, in circulation, and you think about who has that money, and that more of it has been acquired through real estate than everything else combined. So you think about the military industrial complex, or even steel, or you know, making all of the automotive businesses, or all of the technology, Apple, Microsoft, all of that money, right? All of it still does not equal how much wealth has been accumulated and amassed from real estate investing. And that, when somebody told me that, and I heard it more than once, more than I heard somebody else tell me and somebody else tell me, I was like, wow, that's pretty compelling. You know, that means that there's a lot of, you know, room for error. There's a lot of room for forgiveness, because as long as you just stick at it, you'll eventually make money at it. But the thing about it, and why the reason why I believe so many people make so much money in it is, and why, or why we allow there to be so much profit in real estate, is because real estate is rife with risk. There is risk around every corner of real estate. You have liabilities, you know, from the debt to the physical custody of the property. There are also situations of theft. There are situations of injury, casualty, fire, earthquake. You could have pipes that break, or you could have a gas line that breaks. I mean, there's just, and then there's so many things that come along with that too. You could have a sewer pipe that could back up, you know, and now all of your sewage is backing up into the home. There's just the list of risks that are associated with real estate are never ending. They go on forever and ever. And after 12 years of being in the business myself, I found that there are still elements of risk that I am just now identifying, you know.
Right.
So it's not for the weak-hearted, and it's not for anybody that says it's easy is not being completely truthful. There are some elements of it that can be simple and that you can keep it simple, but it certainly is a lot of work, and it certainly takes an intellectual mindset and a lot of patience.
Do you do a lot of public speaking or teaching, or do you focus on your core business of investing?
I feel that being comfortable enough to speak in front of a group is an important quality to have. So I try to regularly exercise that, as opposed to sitting at the back of the room quiet at gatherings. But because of the experience I've had over the years too, I get frequently called upon to participate or share in a group setting. And so I have a number of friends that are very successful in real estate as well. And whenever I go to one of their gatherings, a lot of times they'll call upon me to share for the group some of the things that I've experienced over the years. And I also participate a lot outside of business related things to in our community, such as within our church and everything. I try to, over the years, most recently, I've really tried to focus on giving back. I found that there's something to be said for, you know, there's a lot of successful people out there that talk about how you just have to work really hard and stay dedicated and just get to the grind and just stay on the grind, just work, keep working really hard, and sooner or later you'll make it. But I think a lot of us forget somewhere along the way that at some point you have to take a step back and take a breath, you know, and kind of and reorient yourself with your new surroundings, especially if you've been successful. Because I've also seen a number of successful people out there that have incredible wealth. They could buy anything that they want, but they were incredibly miserable, and some of them even suicidal, you know, to where they don't see the value in their own life, even though they're worth, you know, millions upon millions of dollars, right? And so I've seen that so many times over and over again now that I've had to constantly take a self-assessment and stop and say, take a break, think about this. Is this what you want to be doing? What do you really want to be doing? And I think it's been just recently in years past where I've decided that I don't want to be working alone anymore. Because largely in real estate, it's very easy to find yourself working alone. It's kind of like, you remember that movie Forrest Gump? Yeah, where she tells him, if you get in any trouble, just run, right? And so he's in the Vietnam War, and they're in a battle. All of a sudden, he starts running until he finds himself all alone. And I feel like that happened to me. You know, somewhere along the way, where I felt like I was just working so hard and just focusing on more and more and more and more and more, that I didn't realize that I was working alone and by myself, and how much more enjoyable the whole process could be if I had more teammates. You know, if I had a squad or a crew or a clique that we were able to enjoy all this success together. And so, over the last few years, I've spent more time, including going to networking events in the industry. And I found myself more often than not sharing, you know, more information and giving of it. Whereas in years past, I might have felt that to be intellectual property or trade secrets. Now I'm more willing to share without any sort of agreement to compensation or anything like that. It's just more of a giving back. Because, you know, I found that by giving back and sharing with others, that's where the real value in life comes from. That's when I've been able to feel the best about myself and in life, is when I'm doing something that is not in my self-interest. It's in the interest of others. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's really refreshing to hear that. I'm just, what was I going to ask? I had a few questions I was thinking. My mind just went blank. Yeah, that was fascinating what you were just saying. I was thinking about in terms of like family life balance. I kind of wanted to ask you what advice you would give your younger self, if you know, like your teenage self or your 18-year-old self or something.
Well, my 18-year-old self, it's probably going to be the similar advice that I'm giving to my children that are near that age now. You know, it's such a difficult thing, because I find myself often telling my children the same things that my parents told me, but I didn't listen to them. But yet, for some reason, I feel like they should listen to me, because it's different this time. I don't know. But there's certainly something to be said for learning things yourself and learning the hard way. I've come across a number of successful people lately that are advocating for the idea that you must experience failure in life. That it's a critical component of human development to experience failure, disappointment, loss, because all of these things help properly frame, you know, the value of things in life, the value of
Yes.
human life, right?
And it's
So
hard to understand that until you go through it, isn't it? It's hard to understand that just intellectually. It has to be lived, doesn't it?
yeah, so it's not enough for someone to just tell you, hey, don't do this. If you experience life that was handed to you on a silver platter, and you know, you never really had to go through any heartache or hardship or heartbreak or any of these other things. the sweet is not as sweet without the sour. Right? So if you've never experienced what sour tastes like, would you really truly understand how sweet something can be?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
But I would say in hindsight, going back, I spent so many years single and by myself. I spent many years living the fast life, you know, going out to a lot of the major parties and living it up. And I think at some point in my life, I got to where I realized that those things are not what I want. But for so many years, I chased after them, thinking that it was exactly what I wanted. That I just want to have a good time and enjoy my life and not have any of the downsides that most other people have. You know, like having a family and children and all that. You know.
How old were you when you met your wife?
So my second wife, right now, we've been together now 7 years. But I was previously married before that for just a couple of years. I got married at age 19. So we had a family at a young age, but then I was divorced just a few years later. And due to that heartbreak, I kind of decided to stay single, and I did for more than 10 years until I met my current wife. So
I see.
But I will tell you that there's certainly a joy to having a family and children that there just is no substitute for. You know, there's so many things about raising a child and having a marriage, but that are difficult. I mean, you have two different people that are trying to reconcile their differences on a daily basis. Then when you have children, it just makes it so complicated. There's so many difficult times, especially when they're young. I have a son that's coming up on 2 years old now, and there's so many days where he has a difficult time where all he can do is just scream and cry, you know, to express his frustrations at the world. And sometimes there is no answer for that other than to just be patient. And it's really hard to describe the amount of patience that I have learned just from the experience of raising another child, you know. But yeah. the other part of that too is that, you know, we can be very successful in life. We can have a ton of money and assets, and we can have an incredible amount of success that we've experienced. But, you know, when we're all going to die someday, that's the one thing that we can all accept as a certainty. And when that day comes, you know, assets can be transferred, destroyed. You can't take them with you. And when the assets that we leave behind are transferred to somebody else, it's not like somebody's going to remember us for those things. You know, you sell a house to somebody else, they very quickly forget who had that house before then. If someone else gets your money, I mean, they're not going to think it's your money. They're going to think it's their money, you know? And so there came a point to where I started thinking about a legacy and how can you leave something behind that's meaningful. Then at first it was like, well, in real estate, I could just buy a building like Donald Trump, right? And just put my name on the outside of the building. That would work, right? But how many people can say that they've been able to do that in life? How many people get that opportunity? Not many. But everybody, all of us, most of us anyway, have the ability to raise a child, you know, and have that child be not only carrying forward your DNA, so it's a history, it's literally your legacy, but you also have the ability to shape the personality and character of that person by teaching them many life lessons, right?
I'm also curious. I wanted to ask, is your wife involved? I mean, I don't want to be too nosy, but the reason I'm asking is because I find it difficult to find the right kind of woman. I kept like going for kind of yoga kind of girls. And what I discovered was Because I've got quite an ambitious nature, and I'm quite kind of capitalistic in a way. You know, I'm similar to you. You know, I want to be successful, and I continually kept running into the problem of a lot of these yoga girls. They're not interested in business and stuff like that. You know, they're just into veganism and whatever they're into. And there was like a mismatch, you know. And I really struggled with that. I couldn't figure out what I was doing wrong. And I'm just curious: is your wife kind of involved with your business, or you know, or support? What's the situation with that?
We work together in all things in real estate, and a few years ago she decided to become even more involved by getting her broker license. So now she's a licensed broker, so she's able to help other people buy and sell their home. But to get more to the heart of the matter, I think that you're referring to is that I stayed single for so many years because I had it in my mind that I did not want to be in a relationship with the wrong person. Any time that I was in a relationship with someone that I wanted out of, I found it very difficult for someone like me to face the music on that. And I've seen over the years so many people that are miserable in a relationship. And a lot of times I feel like that's just because, like you said, there was a mismatch where they just didn't, they were with the wrong person. And so I was very thankful that I was single for so many years, because when my current wife did finally come along, I was thankful to be single and available to scoop her right up. And that's really how it happened. As soon as we met, we immediately got together and immediately started our life together. And there was no doubt about whether or not we belonged together. It just felt right for both of us, you know. And it's pretty interesting over the years when I look back on it, because I had many relationships with women over the years, and there were many times where the other woman felt like I was the right person for her, but I did not feel that way. And then there were many other times where I felt like she's the right one, but she didn't feel that way, right? So it makes relationships this very magical thing now when you look at it from this other perspective of that it takes two to make it work. And it's not it, there really is something to be said for the chemistry that you have with someone. But then ultimately, even though my wife and I have fantastic chemistry together, we still have our differences. And we still have our disagreements. And so we've also had to learn how to reconcile those differences and making a choice that I am going to compromise wherever it's necessary to make this work, because I love this woman and I'd do anything to make it work, right? But if the chemistry was not there already, I'm not so certain that any amount of desire to make it work would make it work. You know what I mean?
I see. Yes. I do see.
That's very reassuring,
reassuring
actually
for me
to hear you say,
it was
the right
the right
thing for you to
thing
be
for you to be
single so that
single so
you're
that you're
available,
available,
when you
when
met the
you met
right
the right
person
person
kind
kind
of
of
thing.
thing.
I had
I had
a change
a
in
change in
attitude around
attitude
that
around that
recently. Like
recently,
in the
like in
past,
the
I
past,
always
I
used
always
to
used to
feel
feel
like
like
being
being
with
with
anybody
anybody
was
was
better
better
than
than
nothing,
nothing,
but
but
that
that
was
was
better
better
than
than
being
being
single.
single.
And then, like just recently, I feel like, being single is better than being with the wrong person, you know. Yeah, so I had a shift on that recently.
Yeah, well, it sounds like you're in the right place now,
Yeah, I hope so. I've been going to therapy all year for almost a year now. It's been quite useful actually. I never It's the first time I ever done that. I'd never done it before, but yeah, I'm glad I started that. It's been useful.
it's important to be able to work our way through our own thoughts, you know. Otherwise, we can feel imprisoned by them, you know.
Yeah. Alan, I want to be respectful of your time, but also, could you tell us, your website or any important information if people want to get in contact with you or something? What's the best place to find you?
Yeah, sure. I can be found on Facebook, or I've got a couple different websites. The first one is bentleykensington.com, which is our investment business. And then I also have maxcashoffer.com, which is our acquisitions business of how we acquire real estate.
Okay, that's great. So if people want to look up more information about you, they can go and follow those links. I really appreciate you taking the time to talk to us. It's been really nice hearing your thoughts on a lot of topics.
Same here. I feel like it's been years in the making, this phone call here. So
yeah, I hope we speak again. So I'll put this up online. I'll send you the links. And then if you want to share it with your network, you know, that'll be great.
Sounds good.
All right, Alan. Yeah, thanks for your time. And speak
well,
to you
thank
again.
You.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Hey, you take care.
Bye.
Thanks, Ben.